So in this presentation, we are going to talk about modular protocol design. So basically, what do we understand by that? Modular protocol design consists in designing a protocol for a complex task by composing protocols for single tasks, for simpler tasks. And how do we do that in the UC model? So this is done by using hybrid protocols. A basic hybrid protocol basically is a protocol where parties are allowed to call ideal functionalities for different tasks. And designing protocols this way has several advantages. So basically, a hybrid protocol allows for multiple instantiations because you can replace a call for any ideal functionality by any of the secure realizations of the ideal functionality. And also, a hybrid protocol allows for more structured proofs because it's better to have proofs for secure protocols for each of the ideal functionalities and then proof secure the composition of those ideal functionalities to realize the complex task than having one monolithic proof for a complex protocol. So let's look at it through a simple example. Let's consider that this is a complex functionality, functionality F12, which basically does the following. A party P sends an input A, and the functionality evaluates the functions F1 and F2 on that input, and finally sends the result to the party Q. So basically, we want to provide now a modular protocol to realize this functionality. How do we do that? So we split the task. The first idea that comes to mind is to split the task into two. One functionality that computes, evaluates function F1, and another one for function F2. So we design these two functionalities as follows. Party P sends the input to the functionality, and later on, party Q requests the output, and the functionality evaluates the function on the input and sends Q the result. So how do we use these two functionalities to create a protocol in the hybrid model for functionality F12? So the first idea that comes to mind is very simple. It would be just in step one, the party receives the input A, sends it to the functionality F1. Step two, sends it to the functionality F2. Step three, party Q receives from party P that the functionality has already received the input through a secure channel. And in step four, party Q requests the evaluation of the function from functionality F1. And finally, the party Q does the same with functionality F2, and it can output the results. So this is an idea very simple to compose, to create a protocol modularly for functionality F12, but it doesn't work. And as we can see now, this protocol is not secure, and when a protocol, well, there are security holes, terrible things can happen. So the reason why it is not secure is simply the following. If the party P is adversarial, if it is corrupt, then it can send different inputs to functionality F1 and F2. And F1 and F2 have no way of checking whether P has sent different inputs to them, and the party Q cannot do that either. So we need a mechanism to prevent the adversary from doing that, from sending different inputs to the functionalities. That is, we need a mechanism to ensure that different functionalities receive the same input. So in order to fix this security hole, the first idea that comes to mind is to use commitments, right? So in the real world, how do we use commitments to ensure that different protocols receive the same input? So let's consider that we have a protocol PI1 for functionality F1 and a protocol PI2 for functionality F2 that receive committed inputs. So the idea would be simple. We compute, make P compute a commitment to the input. This commitment is sent from P to Q, and then P and Q could input the commitment to the protocol, both for functionality F1 and functionality F2. So what we would, and thanks to the binding property of the commitment scheme, it is guaranteed that both protocols receive the same input. So what we would like to do is to mirror the same idea, but in the ideal world, using a hybrid protocol. So we would modify, first of all, the functionalities F1 and F2 we proposed before, so that they accept committed inputs. And then use a functionality Fcom to compute commitments in a hybrid model. So the protocol would be as follows, similar as before. Party P sends the input to Fcom, and Fcom produces a commitment. P sends the commitment to Q, and then P and Q send the commitment to the functionality F1 and to the functionality F2. And then Q can obtain the result, and thanks to the binding property, it is guaranteed that both functionalities receive the same input. However, the problem is that existing functionalities that have been proposed so far in the literature for universally composable commitments do not allow for that. They don't, in particular, they don't output cryptographic commitments. I mean, they are not all the same, but the basic behavior they do is the following. The party P sends the input to the functionality, and the functionality tells a party Q, the receiver, that a commitment has been sent, and at a later stage, when party P decides to open the commitment, then functionality sends the input to the party Q. So what we have is that existing functionalities do not output cryptographic commitments or a string that represents a commitment. So what we are going to do in this talk is to fix this problem by proposing an ideal functionality for commitments in C framework that actually outputs cryptographic commitments. And then we will show how we design the protocol for our toy example using this functionality. Finally, in the second part, we will talk about how do we design modularly attribute tokens with revocation by separating the tasks of attribute token and revocation. And we are also going to talk about a new revocation scheme we have. So first of all, the idea of making an ideal functionality that outputs cryptographic commitments is not strange. There are other functionalities for other tasks in the literature that output strings as cryptographic values, such as, for example, functionality of public key encryption that outputs ciphertext, or for signatures, or even for non-interactive zero-knowledge proofs. As we can see in this example, the behavior of these functionalities could be as follows. Let R be a computer binary relation, and for a proof, like the witness and the instance being the relation. So the prover, in this case, would send the witness and the instance to the functionality. The functionality would check that the witness and the instance belong to the relation. And in that case, the functionality would produce a proof that is sent back to the prover. And then party Q here receives as input the proof and the instance, sends it to the functionality, and the functionality verifies whether the proof is correct or not, and sends a verification bit. One thing we can realize here is that normally in all these functionalities, the simulator is called to provide a proof or to verify a proof. And this actually reveals when the party P computes a proof or when the party Q verifies a proof. So in our functionality of commitments, we would like these tasks to be local. So we are going to propose a different mechanism using algorithms to do that. So basically, our functionality, we call it for non-interactive commitments because it actually does not imply interaction between the committer and the verifier. And we, apart from the commit and verify interfaces that compute and verify a commitment, we will have a setup where the simulator provides algorithms so that the functionality computes and verifies those commitments, and a validate interface, which, as we shall see, basically is to verify that a commitment is uses the right parameters. So let's look into the details of our functionality. Our functionality, as I said, requires that computing and verifying commitments are local processes. So what we do is that there is a setup interface that any party can call, and in the setup interface, the functionality calls the simulator so that the simulator provides algorithms commit to compute commitment, open to compute an opening for the commitment, and verify to verify a commitment. And this is done along with parameters of the commitment scheme and a trapdoor. So once the simulator provides this, the functionality tells tells the party that the setup is already done. In this step, the functionality also creates, initializes a table with the following values. The table is empty at the beginning, but it will have the following structure. So a commitment, a message, and an opening, and a bit that basically tells whether the commitment is correct or not. So in the commit interface, basically the functionality receives as input a value from a party, and it computes a commitment as follows. It will run the commit algorithm to compute a commitment. As we can see, the commit algorithm doesn't receive the message as input. It receives a trapdoor. So the trapdoor property implies the hiding property, and we will require trapdoor commitments in order to realize our functionality. Then the functionality will abort if there already exists in the table a commitment with the same value associated to a different message, because this would violate the binding property of required in commitment schemes. Then the functionality runs the opening algorithm so that it creates a correct opening for that commitment, and the opening algorithm does receive the message as input. Info can contain the trapdoor that allows the algorithm to open a commitment to any message. Then the verification algorithm is used to ensure that the commitments and openings produced by those algorithms verify correctly, so it's necessary to run it here. And finally, the functionality will put this commitment in the table, and with a bit one, it indicates that the commitment will always be accepted. And the functionality will send the party a commitment, so a cryptographic commitment and an opening for the commitment, and also the parameter and the verification algorithm, which, as we can see, parameter and verification algorithm are needed by later on functionalities that receive committed inputs in order to verify that this is indeed a commitment for that input by running the verification algorithm. So in the verification interface, as we should expect, the functionality receives a commitment and a message and an opening, along with the parameters and verification algorithm. First of all, the functionality will check that the parameters and verification algorithm are the same as the ones stored before in the functionality. Later on, if the commitment is already stored in the table, it will output the same result to ensure consistency. And if there is already a commitment, that commitment in the table associated to the different message, then it will reject it, because this would violate the binding property we require for commitments. And if the commitment is not in the table, then it will run the verification algorithm and append the result of the verification algorithm to the table, finally send back the result. So as we see, both in the commit and verify functionalities, the simulator is not queried by the functionality, so the simulator doesn't learn when parties compute commitments, thanks to the fact that we use algorithms to compute them. And this ensures the binding property, because the functionality will never accept two different messages as valid for the same commitment. So finally, we have a validate interface, which is basically used to, for a party that only has a commitment but not the opening of it, to check whether that commitment was computed with the same parameters and verification algorithm used by the functionality. Alternatively, we could also make a functionality where those parameters and verification algorithm are output at setup, and then the validate interface is not needed. Both things work. So as for constructions of our functionality, as we can see, we require trapdoor commitments, which implies the hiding property, and we require that the commitment is binding. And we prove that any commitment scheme that is trapdoor and binding realizes our functionality. So in particular, in comparison to the functionality fcom that is in the literature, that could require other properties such as extractability or sometimes non-malleability, we do not require that properties, which allows our functionality to be realized efficiently by, for example, commitment pairs and commitments. And apart from that, having said that, we also propose a variation of our functionality that requires extractable commitments. And the relation between these two functionalities, fnic and finic, would be similar as functionalities for zero-knowledge proofs that require soundness, or functionalities for zero-knowledge proof that require extractability. So in some case, you'd use in your protocol the one you need. In our example, fnic suffices, because mainly because commitments are used always along with zero-knowledge proofs, which already provide the extractability property. So back to our example, now we have described the functionality for non-interactive commitments. We are going to show how we use that functionality to provide a secure protocol in a modular way for our functionality F1.2 that we described it at the introduction. So basically, when the party P receives the input, it will first of all set up the functionality of commitments, then it will send the input to FNIC, to the functionality of commitments to obtain a commitment. Then we modify functionalities F1 and F2 so that they accept committed inputs. So apart from the input, the functionality also receives commitment and opening and the verification algorithm so that functionalities can check the validity of the commitment. Then the functionality would, the party P would communicate to the party Q the commitment using a secure channel and also the verification algorithm. And upon receiving those, the party Q would validate, checking that those verification algorithm and parameters are the ones used by the functionality of commitments. And finally, the party Q, when requesting the result, it will also send the commitment, and the functionalities F1 and F2 will check that the parameters and the commitment are the same as those sent by P, and in that case, they will compute the result and send it to F1 and F2. So basically, now, thanks to the fact that they receive committed inputs and the functionality have this verification algorithm that can be used to check the validity of the commitment, we have proposed a mechanism that ensures that F1 and F2 receive the same value as input. So basically, what we do in the paper is to prove that actually running this verification algorithm, which is provided by the ideal adversary to functionality FNIC, will always ensure the binding properties so that the input is always the same. So we prove that running the verify algorithm will never accept two different messages for the same commitment, and that ensures that the inputs are equal. As we have shown this example of sending the same input to different functionalities, but we note that this could also be used in different ways. For example, ensuring that the output of a functionality equals the input of another functionality. So in the second part of the talk, I'm going to describe briefly how we use this idea to design modularly a protocol for attribute tokens with revocation. So attribute tokens is basically this application where a user gets his attributes certified, like for example, name, municipality, etc., personal data certified by a credential issuer that issues a signature. And then the user uses that credential to prove that he fulfills an access control policy. For example, this credential verifier requires that the user proves that age is more than 16. So the user produces a presentation token, which is basically a non-interactive proof of signature possession that only reveals to the verifier that her age is more than 16, but not any other personal data in the credential. And apart from that, presentation tokens also have unlinkability in the sense that different verifiers cannot link presentation tokens sent by the same user, even if they collude with the credential issuer. So attribute tokens need revocation. Like credentials can be revoked for different reasons, and we add to the setting a revocation authority that basically will establish whether credentials are revoked or not. And this sends information to the credential verifier so that the credential verifier can check that. So what we do in the paper is basically we design a functionality for attribute tokens with revocation, which is a complex task, and then we propose a hybrid protocol, which is modular, and it divides the task into two. One is a functionality for attribute tokens, and another one, a functionality for revocation. Basically, the functionality for attribute tokens is an extension of the non-interactive zero-knowledge functionality, where users get credentials issued on different attributes and on a serial number for the credential. And the functionality will also compute and verify proofs of signature possession. And the functionality FREP is also an extension of the non-interactive zero-knowledge functionality that issues revocation statuses for the serial numbers in the credentials and also computes proofs and verifies proofs that the serial numbers in the credentials are revoked or not. So what we have now is that both functionalities get as input serial numbers, and we employ our functionality for commitments to actually ensure that the serial number received by the functionality of attribute tokens to compute a proof of credential possession equals the serial number received by the revocation functionality. And we propose also constructions for both the attribute token functionality and for the revocation functionality. And we are going to, I'm going to describe only a bit the construction of revocation because it has some advantages over previous constructions. So previously, revocation for attribute tokens was done mainly using accumulators. An accumulator can be seen as a commitment to a set of values. So basically, the accumulator would take the serial numbers and associate its number to a bit. And this bit indicates whether the serial number is revoked or not, depending it's 0 or 1. So basically, this is a binary revocation situation where either a credential is revoked or not. But in many cases, credentials can be revoked locally by different credential verifiers or not. So different credential verifiers can have their own revocation list. So in that case, accumulators are unsuitable because there is some inflexibility there. If you want to have multiple revocation lists, you'd need to create one accumulator for each of the lists, and then adding and removing revocation lists would imply establishing, setting up a new accumulator or removing it. Additionally, accumulators are not hiding, so they could reveal the revocation statuses associated to serial numbers. So what we do is to propose a construction similar to accumulators, but based on vector commitments, because vector commitments actually allow us to associate to each serial number a sequence of bits, and each bit would describe the revocation status with respect to a different revocation list. So if, for example, a credential is revoked with respect to the video streaming, but non-revoked with respect to e-commerce, that could be all accumulated in the vector commitment. And as we can see, then we have the advantages that the vector commitment allows us to revoke, to introduce, to commit to n revocation lists. And this is flexible because it also allows to add and remove revocation lists without extra cost. And it allows for some privacy because the vector commitment actually hides the revocation statuses of its serial number. So in conclusion, we have proposed a new ideal functionality for commitments that we call of non-interactive commitments because it doesn't involve interaction between committer and verifier. And we have shown an efficient construction for it, which can be based on Pedersen commitments. And we have shown how to use that functionality to actually provide a mechanism so that different functionalities in a hybrid protocol receive the same input. And this allows modular design, for example, of attribute-based bits revocation. And we have also proposed this construction for revocation. So thank you for your attention.